Jesus asked, one of the profound questions he asks is, why are you so afraid? I mean, seriously, think about what is it right now in your life that causes you to be afraid? You afraid of failure? Something you're working on? You afraid of loss? Maybe somebody you like, or a dating relationship, or a spouse, or a child? Maybe you fear getting cancer, a heart attack, or some other disease. Maybe you fear a terrorist attack striking somewhere in our country. Maybe you fear the division in our country getting worse and becoming increasingly scary. Watch this.
Today, do not feel safe.
People are scared.
People are going to die.
Our country's going to hell.
2015 was reportedly the best year in history for the average person. So why is everyone so afraid? According to the data, life expectancy is higher than ever before. Violent crime is down, and the air quality has been the cleanest it's been in a decade. But for the media and politicians, your fear is worth billions. Now more than ever, we are plugged into a nonstop feed of information, receiving messages and alerts from our social networks. And because of this, our fears are easy to manipulate.
These threats and these messages about threat are also arriving through many more channels. It's like we've built a new blood supply in our culture, and that blood can deliver nutrients, but that blood, of course, can also deliver toxins.
So what do we do when people are hardwired to respond to fear above everything else?
The long-term solution really comes from people realizing that their brain is not a perfect device. Every thought you have is not necessarily correct. Your emotion system will take those thoughts and kind of run them like a boat down a stream.
In reality, we probably won't die from a terrorist attack or mass shooting. Every day there are 117 deaths from suicide, 129 deaths from overdose, 96 deaths from car accidents, and 1,300 deaths from smoking. So the message is clear.
Maybe you fear the microphone not working. How about this one? Fear something bad happening to one of your kids. I remember when our boys, Tad and David, went to summer high school houseboat camp at Lake Shasta. They called when they were coming home. They said, we're not coming with the buses. We're going to be in one of the vans coming late. We'll get home about 1 a.m. So you don't have to pick us up in the middle of the night. Why don't you leave a car there for us? So I did. So I went to bed, and 1 a.m., no kids. 2 a.m., still no boys, no call. 3 a.m., still nobody, nothing. And I'm starting to, you know, picture the van going off I-5 and down a ravine where nobody could see them. All night was just, you know, hardly any sleep at all. First thing in the morning, I called the youth leader, and I said, you know, where are our boys? Oh, they're probably okay. I think they've slept at the church. Yeah, you're good. I said, well, thanks for letting us know. You know, I'm thinking that, and, you know, this is crazy. Thanks for the great night's sleep. Fears, we all have them. The question is, what do we do with them? Jesus' disciples experienced fear. In Mark 4, 35 to 41, if you'd like to follow along in the Bibles that we provide under the seats in front of you, it's on page 1005. We find the disciples in total panic. That day, when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was. That's a crazy line. They took him along just as he was. I mean, was he still in his pajamas? Was he having a bad hair day? I don't know. They took him along in the boat. There were also other boats with them. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. Now, first century Palestine fishing boats, they used heavy nets. They would store the nets under the stern in kind of a nook. It was impractical for somebody to sleep on the stern. It wasn't protected. So we picture that Jesus went, you know, a little bit below deck under the stern. He was laying on the nets. Mark says he was sleeping on a cushion. This wasn't a fluffy pillow like you sleep on at night. This was a 100-pound leather ballast bag filled with sand used to balance the boat. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." Lord Jesus, thank you for this account that you have power to still a storm. And Father, we have fears today. You asked the disciples why they're so afraid. It still works today, Lord. We have lots of fears. People take so many anxiety pills. There's just so much going on, Lord. And so today we want to answer the question, why are you so afraid? Speak to us about this. Be our teacher, Lord Jesus. We're ready to hear. In Jesus' name, amen. You'd think with Jesus in the boat, the disciples would not be afraid, but they were. But at least they had the wisdom to come to Jesus for help. Jesus wants us to take our fears, identify them, and bring them to him. Following Christ means putting our faith in him. I want to ask two questions of you and this text today. First, do you have faith that Jesus is God's son? Jesus and the disciples took a boat across the lake. The Sea of Galilee is like 7 miles wide, 13 miles long, pretty big lake. And it's known for its storms, particularly in the evening, and that's when this was. A fierce wind hit the lake like a lion out of the grass. One moment the disciples are shuffling cards for a mid-journey game of progressive rummy, and the next they're gulping seawater. Wind and waves are swamping their boat. This is one of those tie yourself to the mast, kiss your boat goodbye storms. What's going on here? Aren't Jesus' disciples supposed to experience a calendar of Caribbean cruises? No, Jesus never promises that we will not face storms. He doesn't promise us an easy life, free of suffering. But he promises he will always be with us. And if the storm isn't bad enough, Mark adds that they found Jesus in the back of the boat sleeping. Well, what's wrong with this picture? I remember as a boy, my mom reading to me books that, you know, where they at the bottom of the page it says, what's wrong with this picture? And, you know, you're supposed to find it. So I got a couple for you. So, okay, what's wrong with this one? Just shout it out. Okay, dog. Let's do the next one. What's wrong with this picture? What? What's wrong? Shout it out. Coke. Okay, we got one more for you. This is the hardest one. What's wrong with this picture? The white duck. Okay. All right, good job. You guys are pretty quick. Okay, so that's what happens here. The disciples are scared, their boat is swamping, and they come back to Jesus and he's asleep. He's curled up asleep. It just doesn't fit. They wake Jesus by saying, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" They don't ask about his strength. Could you stop the storm? They don't ask about his knowledge. Are you aware there's a storm? They question his character. Don't you care if we drown? Fear does this. Fear corrodes our confidence in God's goodness. We wonder, is there anybody in heaven that gives a rip about me, even sees what's going on with me? Jesus got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then as fast as you can say glassy, the water became completely calm. Then he said to the disciples, "Why are you so afraid?" This is the question we want to answer today in our profound questions Jesus asked. They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." Mark wants us to see that although the disciples had seen Jesus heal many people, seen him cast out demons from a number of people, they still are in awe that he can calm the wind and the waves. They're still trying to get their arms around, who is Jesus? One thing is for sure, we can't ignore him. Who would want to? There he is, the most significant person who ever walked on this earth. Forget MVP. He's the entire league. Head of the parade? Hardly. No one else is on the street. Bit by bit, Mark is trying to get us to draw the same conclusion that he has drawn, that Jesus is the Son of God. That's why he can command wind and waves to stop. He's the same Yahweh of the Old Testament who has divine power over nature. Mark states his hypothesis up front. The beginning of the gospel about Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Then in the first chapter, we meet a demon who says to Jesus, "What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." In Mark 2, he meets a paralyzed man and he says, "Your sins are forgiven." And the Jewish religious leaders say, "He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" And that's just Mark's point. Jesus is God in human form. In Mark 5, another demon identifies Jesus. We looked at this a couple weeks ago. "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God?" Then in Mark 15, Mark is reaching the end of his argument, the resurrection, which will be the final proof that Jesus is God's Son. And a centurion stands in front of Jesus dying on the cross and says, "Surely this man was the Son of God." You say, "I don't know if I can draw the same conclusion. I mean, how do we know Jesus really did these miracles? Maybe the early church made them up after the fact to make Jesus larger than life." I mean, it's unscientific to believe in something that can't be tested, and we can't prove that he did these miracles. You know, you're right about that. We can't prove miracles that happened 2,000 years ago. We can't repeat them. But you have to understand, it's just as unscientific to not believe in the miracles. To not believe in the miracles, you have to throw out all the historical evidence. You have to throw out the New Testament documents that are the best attested documents in all of history. I mean, you read other history about Aristotle, Julius Caesar, Napoleon. You assume those are true, don't you? So why, when it comes to Jesus, do we get to throw out the documents and say those things never happened? It's a crazy double standard. Mark doesn't try to convince you that Jesus is God's Son on the evidence of the miracles alone. Jesus tried to avoid using miracles to wow people, coerce people into believing in him. We find only 35 recorded miracles in the New Testament, the Gospels. Jesus' ministry lasted 3 years. That means he did one a month. He did 20 healing miracles. He did 6 exorcism miracles, casting out a demon. And he did 9 nature miracles, turning water into wine, feeding the 5,000, feeding the 4,000, catching fish twice, causing a fig tree to shrivel, producing a coin in a fish's mouth, walking on water, and then this one, calming the storm. Although in addition, we're told on a number of occasions he healed many people and cast out many demons, the overall impression in the Gospels is how sparingly Jesus used miracles. He made no attempt to heal everyone. The miracles were not intended to prove his deity. The resurrection would take care of that. Rather than proving his deity, the miracles were an expression of his compassion for hurting people. Although Jesus did not do miracles to prove that he was God, he expected them to be noticed. He condemned people that saw his miracles yet still did not repent. Mark expects us to sit up and take notice. In light of Jesus calming the storm, he asks us, who do you believe Jesus is? Do you believe that he's God's son? If you've never done so, isn't it time that you told Jesus you believe he's God's son and invite him to come into your life? Second, do you have faith that Jesus can calm the storms in your life? We all experience troubled waters. Who hasn't felt what the disciples felt when the storms rage and the winds blow? Waves of chaos beat against you. Troubles are part of life. And often God allows them to teach us to turn to him. In the sudden storm, the disciples turned to Jesus. What troubles are you facing? What fears do you have? Are they causing you to turn to Jesus, or are you trying to do everything yourself? Stand-up comedian Dave Barry, in his book Live Right, Find Happiness, says that the massive do-it-yourself industry is all based on a lie. And he uses as his prime example commercials by Home Depot. On a commercial, you see an attractive young couple come into the store. They're looking at tiles and wood samples. And about 8 seconds later, after brandishing paintbrushes for a second and then drilling a hole with protective eyeglasses on, they stand there in their beautiful new kitchen and say, "Look, we did it all ourselves." Really, Home Depot? I mean, that hasn't been my experience. I don't find attractive young couples there. I find people that are beaten down with broken houses, glumly pushing their huge orange carts down endless aisles, looking in bafflement at displays of home products. Listen to the way Dave Barry puts it. They're wondering, should they get the 5 3/8 one with the ribbed flange? Or the 7 9/16 one with the reverse coupling? Or maybe the 37 millimeter one, whatever a millimeter is? Or maybe just grab the one that says, as seen on TV, knowing in their hearts that whatever one they pick, it probably won't work, and even if it does, it'll eventually break because it is part of a house. You know how drug commercials they're required to say the warnings? Like after they tell you the wonderful things the drug will do, then they have to give you the warnings that this, you know, there's some side effects like death. Dave Barry says you ought to do the same thing with the do-it-yourself industry, Home Depot commercials. At the end, when they're showing you the happy couple in their new do-it-yourself kitchen, an announcer would say, these people are actors. They're not capable of operating an espresso machine, let alone build this kitchen. This was done by contractors with trucks. He says, I'd like to see somebody open a chain of stores called Reality Hardware. When homeowners want to tackle a home improvement project, they'd go to Reality Hardware and discuss it with a knowledgeable employee who would talk them through it. Homeowner, I want to install a ceiling fan. Employee, really? Homeowner, yes. Employee, you want to install a machine with long, sharp blades whirling at high speeds directly over the heads of live human beings? Homeowner, well, yes. Employee, I see. And do you have any particular expertise in this area? Any training in the field of ceiling fan installation? No, not in ceiling fan installation per se. Employee, in what then? homeowner, I'm a dentist. Employee, I see. And would you be comfortable having a professional ceiling fan installer give you a root canal? Homeowner, well, no, but that's a diff. Employee, I'd like you to take a look at this photograph of a recent do-it-yourself ceiling fan installation. Homeowner, oh my goodness, is that? Yes, his hand, it landed 8 feet away. Homeowner, I think I'll hire a professional. Employee, yes, with a truck. Mark wants us to put our faith in Christ. He doesn't want us to blunder through life trying to do it ourselves. Whenever I do a home project, which isn't often, I always pray, God, I'm not very good at this. Would you help me? Jesus wants us to overcome our fears by putting our trust in him. Jesus is surprised that the disciples are so afraid with him in the boat. He says to his disciples, why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? Jesus doesn't want us to be afraid. Of 125 commands Jesus gives in the four Gospels, 21 have to do with not being afraid more than any other subject. So don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. Don't be afraid. Just believe. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Jesus came and touched them and said, get up. Don't be afraid. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. Why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your minds? One fear that destroys so many people is the fear that I don't matter. Max Lucado, in his book Fearless, tells about kids that felt that way in an orphanage in China for the deaf and mute. China's one-child policy has a way of weeding out the weak. Males are chosen over females. Healthy babies are chosen over the impaired. Children who can't speak and can't hear hardly have a chance to have a healthy, productive life, if they even survive. Wherever they turn, they're told, you don't matter. So whenever they learn otherwise, they melt. Missionary John Bentley tells about one such time. Children who couldn't speak, couldn't hear, were in a Chinese orphanage in the Henan province. And they were all given a book translated into Mandarin of Max Lucado's book, You Are Special. It's a story of Punchinello, a little wooden boy who lived in a village of all wooden people. Their village had a practice of putting stars on their achievers and dots on their strugglers. Punchinello had so many dots, people would just put dots on him for no reason at all. And then one day he met Eli, his maker. Eli says, don't just disregard what other people say about you. I made you, and I don't make any mistakes. Punchinello had never heard anything like this. And as he let it sweep over him, his dots began to fall off. And the children in the orphanage had the same experience. As they handed out the books and they began to read, when they got to a certain place, they all began to cry. Just to learn that they were special because they were made by a loving creator. They'd never heard this before. And Bentley said, It was unbelievable to watch. All the students, even the staff, they all begin to cry. Do you need this reminder? That you matter because you were made by a loving God? You have to deal with that fear. If you don't, that fear will become a self-fulfilling prophecy that will destroy your life. You know, it works like this. You're working at a menial job, low paying. It's not in your wheelhouse of experience and your skills. You get home every night exhausted. You get just enough money from the job to pay your bills, but nothing more. Then one day you see an ad for a job that's right in your experience and your skills. And in a moment of uncharacteristic courage, you send in your resume. The employer calls and sets up an interview. And that's when this whole thinking of I don't matter begins to descend on you. You think, once they get to know me, they won't like me. They'll ask me questions I can't answer, and I'll do terribly. And I'll have no chance of getting the job. And sure enough, you get to the interview, and you flop miserably, and you descend another level into the basement of self-defeat. Or you're a young girl, and a good-looking guy asks you out. So good-looking that you're thinking, what does he see in me? He's way out of my league. I mean, once he gets to know me, he'll drop me. And you're wondering if you'll even be able to maintain his interest through the evening. And so your insecurity drives you to depend on the only tool you can trust, your body. You sleep with him on the first date. And you become the disposable woman you didn't want to become. Another fear is that things are so bad, there's no use in trying. A friend sent me an email a few years ago, and I love when you send me emails of how God's working in your life, amazing things that have happened. And he says his daughter Jessica wanted to try out for a solo part in the children's choir. But when they announced it, she knew there was no point in signing up because her mom would never let her go. She was with her mom every other weekend, and any time she'd asked to do something on her mom's weekend with church, her mom had always said no. So when they announced it on Sunday morning, the tryouts would be next Sunday, she ran back to her father, my friend, and said, I'd love to try out, but I don't see any point. Mom won't let me go. There's no way. And he says, you're right. She won't. But God can help you. He says, after choir, why don't you come and we'll pray? So they went down to a Sunday school all by themselves, and they prayed. And before they prayed, he asked her, you know, is this God's will? Why do you want to have a soul? And deciding that it was God's will, they prayed. He promises to grant what we ask for in his will. And so then in the car on the way home that night to her mom's house, her sister Veronica is saying, you know, there's no point, Jessica, in asking mom. She'll never let you go. He'll never let us try out. So when Jessica got there, the first thing she asked her mom when they came in the door is, Mom, we're having tryouts next week for a soul. I want to try out. Can I try out? And immediately her mom said, yes. And the father said to me in the note, I couldn't believe it. If I hadn't been there, I would not have believed it. God is so amazing. A father and daughter learned that with Christ, there is nothing that you can't try. Another fear is that God doesn't care about me. This may be the worst one of all. Natalie Grant sings a song called Held. It's a song about a woman, mother, who loses her two-month-old baby. And she's crying out, God, why? I thought you were supposed to protect me of tragedies like this. I try to follow you faithfully. What's going on? And she learns that Jesus' promise is not that we won't have bad things happen, that we won't suffer, we won't face even death. The promise is that he will always be with us. He will hold us. Watch this. many people, your family members, friends, classmates, who don't follow Christ, don't believe that God gives a rip about them. And you say to them, Jesus never promised that you won't face rough waters. His promise is to be with you. Why don't you come to church with me and learn more about him? Why are you so afraid? Do you have faith to believe that Jesus is God's Son? And that he is with you through the storms in your life? Lord Jesus, thank you that you stilled the storm and you want to do the same for us. You want to be with us in the midst of our storms, and you're the Son of God. You make all the difference in the world. I want you to pray. Maybe you've never told Jesus that you believe he's God's Son, and you're ready to do that today. You just tell him, I believe you're God's Son. Thank you that you died for me. I want you to forgive my sins and come into my life. You can do that right where you're seated. Maybe you have put your faith in Christ, but you have got stuff going on that's got you afraid. You don't know what to do with it. Thank him that he's with you. You pray right now. Thank you, Jesus. We want to try this week differently. Rather than being so worried about things, we want to turn to you and put our faith in you that you can help us through them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, take out your program, would you? As Chris said to you earlier, there's communication.